digital.
Making movies was his art and his life. Akira Kurosawa, a cinema giant, his films gave many of us in the West our first look at Japanese culture and society. Now we'll take our first real look at him.
Look for me in the characters in the films I made.
Kurosawa, Japan's greatest filmmaker. Next on Great Performances. To you by Ernst & Young. Proud corporate sponsor of great performances, Ernst & Young, from thought to finish. This program was also made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
Elevated standard in audio performance celebrates the performing arts. Sony ES.
The Lewester T. Mertz Charitable Trust, the Irene Diamond Fund, and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
The Academy's Board of Governors has voted an honorary Academy Award to a man who many of us believe is our greatest living filmmaker, and all of us know is one of the few true visionaries ever to work in our medium.
In 1990, at the age of 80, the Japanese director Akira Kurosawa was given an honorary Oscar at the Academy Awards in Hollywood.
Until
his death in 1998, Kurosawa directed over 30 films, including Rashomon, Seven Samurai, Throne of Blood, and Ron. And his work was a huge influence on directors like George Lucas and Steven Spielberg, who revered him as a master of the cinema. He was criticized in Japan for appealing to an international audience, yet he did more than anyone else to reveal Japanese society to the West. Born in 1910, Kurosawa's career spanned the most dramatic century in Japan's history, and its transformation from a semi-feudal empire into an industrial superstate.
In the pre-war era, When itinerant home remedy salesmen still wandered the countryside, they had a traditional patter for selling a potion that was supposed to be particularly effective in treating burns and cuts. A toad, with four legs in front and six behind, would be placed in a box with mirrors lining the four walls. The toad, amazed at its own appearance from every angle, would break into an oily sweat. This sweat would be collected and simmered for 3,721 days. The result was the marvelous potion. Feel something like that toad in the box. I have to look at myself from many angles over many years, whether I like what I see or not. I may not be a ten-legged toad, but what confronts me in the mirror does bring on something like the toad's oily sweat. I can now recall only a few events from my babyhood in a form resembling out-of-focus film footage. All of them are things seen from my infant's vantage point on my nurse's shoulders. One of them is something seen through a sort of net. Later, I understood that this was the view from behind the net of a baseball field at the gymnastics school where my father was a teacher. My father was a strict man of military background. After he left the Army Academy, he took a position at a gymnastics school. He built Japan's first swimming pool, and he worked to make baseball popular. When I was small, it seems that I was very weak and sickly. My father used to complain about this state of affairs.
The original samurai were warriors who followed a strict feudal code based on unquestioning loyalty to their lord. Over the
the centuries, they lost most of their power, but they retained their position as the elite of Japanese society. As a child from a samurai family, Kurosawa was expected to acquire the appropriate skills and sense of responsibility of a member of his class.
In primary schools of the Taisho era, kendo swordsmanship was added to the regular curriculum, beginning in the fifth grade. My father was more than agreeable to my devoting myself to kendo and insisted that I take calligraphy lessons as well. Moreover, I was instructed to be sure to pay my respects at the Hachiman Shrine on the way back from my morning kendo lesson in order to develop the proper spirit. I cannot understand why my father, who loved calligraphy so much, could have sent me to study with the kind of teacher he did. I was unable to find anything interesting about the teacher's calligraphy. His writing was without flavor or fragrance, just like printed characters in a book. I had my father's orders, however, so I went to the school every day, and using the teacher's calligraphy as a model, I practiced writing. But you can't love what you don't like. When I left the calligraphy school, I was still at the stage of writing four-character poems on large sheets of paper in block-style script. To this day, I'm very good at that kind of calligraphy, but if I have to write anything smaller than that, or write characters in cursive script, it's no good at all. My father's attitude was one of extreme severity. My mother, who came from an Osaka merchant's family and was thus less sensitive to the finer points of samurai etiquette, received frequent scoldings about the fish set out on the individual meal trays. Idiot, are you trying to make me commit suicide? Apparently there was a special procedure for serving a meal that precedes a ritual suicide. It seems it extended to the position of the fish on the plate. When you are served a fish on a meal tray, usually its head points to the left and its belly is towards you to make it easy to reach. If you are going to commit suicide, I gather that it is served with its head pointing to the right and its belly away from you, because it would be insensitive to place a cut fish belly directly facing someone who is about to cut open his own abdomen. My father had worn his hair in a samurai topknot as a child, and even at the time these scoldings occurred, he would frequently take a formal position with his back to the art alcove and hold his sword straight up to polish the blade with abrasive powder. The location is a streetcar crossing. On the other side of the tracks are my father, mother, and siblings. A white dog scampers back and forth across the tracks, wagging his tail. After he's repeated this action several times and is just heading back in my direction, the train suddenly hurtles past. Right before my eyes, the white dog tumbles down, split nearly in half. The body of the instantly killed beast was round and bright red, like a tuna sliced crossways for sashimi. The clarity of my memory seems to improve in direct proportion to the intensity of the shock I underwent. I have no recollection at all of anything subsequent to this awful spectacle. It probably threw me into such a shock that I lost consciousness. But for more than 30 years after this incident, I was unable to eat sashimi or sushi made of fish with red flesh.
On September 1st, 1923, a massive earthquake struck the Tokyo region of Japan. The firestorm which followed destroyed two-thirds of the city and killed nearly as many people as the atomic bomb on Hiroshima. Kurosawa was 13 years old at the time.
When the Holocaust had died down, my brother Heiko said to me, "Akira, let's go and look at the ruins." For an entire day, he led me around the vast area the fire had destroyed. And while I shivered in fear, he showed me a countless array of corpses. Amid this expanse of nauseating redness lay every kind of corpse imaginable. I saw corpses charred black, half-burned corpses, corpses in gutters, corpses floating in rivers, corpses piled up on bridges, corpses blocking off a whole street at an intersection, and every manner of death possible to human beings displayed by corpses. When I involuntarily looked away, my brother scolded me, "Akira, look carefully now." My brother said, "If you shut your eyes to a frightening sight, you end up being frightened. If you look at everything straight on, there's nothing to be afraid of." Looking back on that excursion now, I realize it must have been horrifying for my brother too. It had been an expedition to conquer fear. At this time, my brother had taken a great step. He had become a professional silent film narrator. The narrators not only recounted the plot of the films, they enhanced the emotional content by performing the voices and sound effects and providing evocative descriptions of events and images on the screen.
Jokan Gonzales no tetaraku ni heishira wa kaisai o sakebu. Goyu Musou Zoro no Ken, Sae ni Saeru! Hey! Do that! Nikki Zoro!
アンカって言うとセリフで説明しちゃったりしてるわけですよ。説明っていうのは大変つまんないことですよね。で、そういう説明的なところは全部なるだけ取るようにしていくんですけど、それもやっぱりサイレント映画に帰って、サイレントの映画の原点に帰って考え直すと、そういうところも分かってくるわけでね。そういう意味でサイレント映画っていうのは今でも研究してるし、でなんか作品を作る時にはこれを例えばこのシーンをサイレントで撮ったらどうなるっていう、どうやる表現があるだろうっていう具合に考えて、その余計なセリフは喋らないで済ませるようになるだけしているんですけどね。そこへこう集約するように考えてるからね、映画をとにかく一生追求するのは一生の仕事だと思ってますからね。いろんなものを美術にしても小説にしても、まあ映画っていうのはね、その多分に文学的なところもあるし、演劇的なところもあるし、美術的なところもあるし、音楽的なところもあるし、いろんな要素が一つになってるけども、やっぱり映画は映画なんでね。
Kurosawa's first ambition was to be an artist. He studied Western-style painting and became part of a group calling themselves the Proletariat Artists League, who talked about revolution and espoused radical left-wing political views. His only surviving early work shows the influence of socialist realism and Marxist ideology. Western influences which conflicted with the conservatism which pervaded Japanese life. The majority of Japanese believed that the emperor, who claimed descent from the sun goddess, was a divine figure. Until after the war, school children bowed to his image every morning, and he was the supreme head of the hierarchy on which Japanese society was constructed.
ただその侍の軍人のうちから出てね、でその画家になること自身ね、まあもちろんプロレタリア運動に参加すること自体って非常に大勢の人だがなったんだけども、それはやはり一種のスキャンダルと見られてたでしょうね。家族から見ればね。この画家になるとかね、それからまあ映画界ってことになる、まあそうです、そうですが、その階級からのこの脱落者っていうことで下に落ちたっていうね、まあ一種のドロップアウトだと思いますね。
Kurosawa was following in the footsteps of his elder brother Heigo.Who had also disappointed their father by adopting an unconventional bohemian way of life. Heigo lived in a rundown traditional quarter of Tokyo, and he cut a glamorous figure in the artistic avant-garde circles of the time. At the age of 27, Heigo and his girlfriend committed a double suicide.
He treated me to dinner 3 days before his suicide. We said our goodbyes at Shin Okobo Station. We were in a taxi. As my brother got out, he told me to take the cab all the way home. But when the car started up again, he motioned the driver to stop. "What is it?" I said. He looked at me very hard for a moment, and then said, "Nothing. You can go now." The next time I saw him, he was covered with a bloody sheet. The death of my brother left me the only son, and I began to feel a sense of responsibility towards my parents. I became impatient with my own aimlessness.
In 1936, Kurosawa answered a newspaper advertisement for assistant directors at a company called Photochemical Laboratories, which later became Toho Film Studios. At the age of 26, he was given the job. Kurosawa showed an early flair for writing scripts, which were then shot by other directors. Japan had been at war in China since 1931, so the majority were propaganda stories like this one about test pilots. As an assistant director, he had to serve a long and poorly paid apprenticeship, so script writing was a way of increasing his meager salary.
発動機の回転は、うん、よく言えば少し足りないのか気もするけど、まあとにかく傑作だよ。久しぶりで思うと思うとんでみたよ。クロさんはね、チャーミングで背脂がなんか、ええ、僕らもう本当に、体制は高いしね、2枚目だしね、それからもう助監督時代からどんどん優秀なね、シナリオを書いてましたからね。ええ、だからもう、
あいつは監督になるとすごくいいもの取るんじゃないかななんてね。多分にその国策的なね、こう要求をされるわけですよね。で、こういうことを盛り込んでくれとかね。なるだけそういうのには抵抗したけどもね。そういう時代にその国で生きていくためにはね、で、仕事をする上にはある程度のものを入れざるを得ないんですよね。
The Most Beautiful is about a group of young women working in a factory producing lenses for Japanese fighter planes.
I mean, you don't have to show the enemy as being particularly awful because the orders are simply to do what we tell you to do, and that's the reason you do it. Not that the enemy is awful, but that your own government is very kindly telling you exactly what to do, and then you do this. This is what his picture is about. This is indeed what he was about at this point.
Later, it came to pass that I married the girl who played the leader of the girls' volunteer corps, Yoko Yaguchi. The Most Beautiful is not a major picture, but it is the one dearest to me. On August the 15th, 1945, I was summoned to the studio along with everyone else to listen to the momentous proclamation on the radio. The emperor himself was to speak over the airwaves. On the way from Soshigaya, the shopping street looked fully prepared for the honorable death of the 100 million. The atmosphere was tense, panicked. If the emperor had not delivered his address, urging the Japanese people to lay down their swords. If that speech had been a call instead for the honorable death of the 100 million, those people on that street in Soshigaya would probably have done as they were told and died. And probably I would have done likewise. The Japanese see self-assertion as immoral and self-sacrifice as the sensible course to take in life. We were accustomed to this teaching and had never thought to question it.
Medley Knight is here again. Our time for bringing you something old, something new, something borrowed, and something blue.
In September 1945, American troops led by General MacArthur arrived in Japan to begin an occupation which was to last for 7 years. MacArthur's mission was to transform Japan by introducing democratic institutions and political and economic reforms. Thousands of American troops were sent to Japan, a country which had never been invaded before. The Japanese had been instructed by their emperor to endure the unendurable, and they offered no resistance to the occupying forces. The film that Kurosawa was directing when the war ended was a story based on a kabuki drama about a feudal lord being led to freedom through enemy territory by a band of loyal followers. Because the story seemed to celebrate traditional feudal values, which the new administration was determined to suppress, the film was not released until 1952, after the occupation ended.
From time to time, American soldiers visited the studio where I was shooting. One day, a whole landing party of them converged on my set. Maybe the customs being shown in my productions struck them as quaint. I don't know. At any rate, they clicked away with their still cameras or buzzed away with 8mm cameras, and some even wanted to be photographed while being slashed at with a Japanese sword. Things got so out of hand, I had to call a halt to the day's shooting. Offered no resistance to Japan's militarism. Unfortunately, I have to admit that I didn't have the courage to resist in any positive way, and I only got by ingratiating myself when necessary, and otherwise evading censure. I'm ashamed of this, but I must be honest about it. The freedom and democracy of the post-war era were not things I had fought for and won. They were granted to me by powers beyond my own. As a result, I felt it was all the more essential for me to approach them with an earnest and humble desire to learn and to make them my own. But most Japanese in these post-war years simply swallowed the concepts of freedom and democracy whole, waving slogans around without really knowing what they meant.
underlying the ethos under which he'd made films before then was, of course, that you must subject whatever individuality you have to the common cause and so forth. And here, in just a matter of a week, it was the exact opposite, where you were expected to sprout instant individuality. Kurosawa didn't lose his head, as many people did do. He kept to his last, that is, which was making good workmanlike pictures.
In the late 1940s, the Japanese film industry was torn apart by a succession of strikes. The union had been taken over by members of the Communist Party, who demanded workers' control of the industry. In 1948, a final battle between management and workers at Kurosawa's studio, Toho, became so inflamed that the Americans decided to intervene.
In order to guard the studio against daily assaults, the employees set up camp in the studio itself, and the place took on the air of a fort. The lighting technicians set up their spots to prevent anyone sneaking in during the night. But the greatest work of genius was the fans. They set up wind machines just inside the front and back gates of the lot, facing outward like heavy artillery. In the event of a storming of the gates, they were ready with a huge amount of cayenne pepper to toss in front of the fan blasts and blind the oncoming enemy. There were armored police cars at the studio front gate, American tanks at the back, and patrol planes flying overhead. Against these, our giant fans and cayenne pepper were totally ineffectual. We had no alternative but to hand over the studio to the company management.
Drunken Angel, Kurosawa turned his cameras on the social chaos of the immediate post-war years. After a decade of wartime austerity, many Japanese reveled in the new atmosphere of indulgence and excess. But for Kurosawa, the dangers of this social upheaval were clear. The film's central character is a new kind of post-war individual, a young gangster dying of tuberculosis who refuses to give up his depraved life. He was played by an unknown actor, Toshiro Mifune, who had no formal training and had only recently been discharged from the army.
ところが映画を作ってる間に三船敏郎があまりに素晴らしかったんで、それでね、その快楽にのめり込んだまま滅びていく人間が、とても魅力的になってしまった。その時、これは自分は失敗だな、間違ったなと思ったんだけれども、現に目の前に本当に素晴らしいものが生まれてくるのにね、それを抑えることはできなかったと黒沢さんおっしゃってますね。それは実はね、 当時10代でその映画を見た我々のね、気持ちでもありました。
夜トレの時にね、初めてなんかこう伸び伸びとね、こう仕事ができたんですよね。そのごく自然に、その意識、こういうことしよう、こういうことしようってこう意識してね、それでもって自分を規制してものを作ってるんじゃなくてね、あの時はなんかすごく楽な気持ちでね、ごく自然に仕事ができたんでね、あ、これが僕の本来の生き方になるんじゃないかなって、そういう感じがしたんでね。
In the film, which was to establish him as a director of international importance, Kurosawa questioned the nature of truth by showing the same story from dramatically different points of view. The film depicts a murder and rape set in medieval Japan. The intensity of the kiss between the bandit and the woman shocked Japanese audiences. Kurosawa used mirrors to light the actors and to heighten the effect of the sun. Rashomon's star, Machiko Kyo, and the surviving members of the film crew have not revisited the temple location in Kyoto since they shot the film 50 years ago. On its release, Rashomon confused Japanese audiences, but it became an astonishing success in the West. Was entered in the 1951 Venice Film Festival, where it won the coveted Golden Lion Award.
あれぐらいでも5年ぐらいになりますよ。あ、そうなの。こっちはダンサーしてるもちろん。あ、はい。みたいね。あ、でにゃ。レジョンもそう。さあ、あの時あの、さっきからまあ話で出てるんですけど、鏡でですね、太陽光線もにこう当てたでしょ。ええ。しなかったでしょうね。まばたきしちゃいけない。いけないでしょ。うん。まあ、何だろう。でもね、若いからあれができるの。 でなかったらほら、ロケーション普通昼間お天気がいいと目がしょぼしょぼするでしょ、こういうふうに。若いと割とパチッと見てられるのね。 何しろあのほら黒沢さんがあのキスシーンの時に横で「京ちゃん目開けたまま目開けたまま」
覚えて
ますね、言ってたでしょ。それでね私にね「どうも女の人はやっぱりああいう時目つぶるんだな」って言うのよ。
そう、
うん、いや目開けて目開けて一生懸命目開けてね、
うん、
あいそんなことって痛かったでしょ目開けたまま。
それも痛いですけど、うん、夢中だからね。
レプリカあるじゃん。
あ
これもらったんだってあのパーティーの時みんな私を知らん
私いただいてますよ。
世界のその映画のそのそういう情勢あんまり分かんなかったですもんね。
そうあの今みたいにほらもう即日1時間後にはヨーロッパの話が日本へ来てるという時代じゃなかったから、う
ん、ないですもんね。ああ
なんか日本の映画をね外国で見てもらうなんてのは
そうそうなかったから全然なかったですもんね、うんうん、
でも
それあれないね撮影所の中は別にわーっと湧くようなことなかった
ね。
だから報道関係の方が作詞って、うん、それから撮影所のものが分かったというぐらいだね、う
ん、知らなかった。
本当のありがたみを分かんなかったんでしょうね。
羅生門がなければねそれまでは戦後の日本っていうのはただ占領下で何も知られてないですよ。で時々地震があるっていう国ですよね。でそのしばらく前はあのいわゆる特攻隊の自殺飛行機だな特攻隊ので有名だったでしょ。でとにかくその積極的に何か日本人が作ったっていうことはもう認知されたのは知られたのは羅生門ですからこれはもう大変なそれはもうありがたいことでしたね。
When a prize is won by a Japanese abroad usually it has two effects, one of which you know our side won, but very often very soon afterwards comes well since the foreigners understood it so well it can't be too much like us can it because we're inscrutable and therefore if we're understood it's not us anymore. And the fact that they made so much about Rashomon means that she's an un-Japanese in a kind of way. Very shortly this kind of criticism came up and this kind of criticism of course is his beleaguered Kurosawa in his entire career and to be told that he makes films for Westerners is a sure way to raise a mighty storm and it's not true anyway.
例えば日本の評価なんかはねあれはただエグゾティズムに対してね興味持ってあの賞をくれたったらベニスの審査員たちは怒りましたよ。そんなもんじゃないって言ってだからそうじゃないんですよね。やっぱり共通した人間の問題があるわけですよ世界中に。それがちゃんと描けていかなかったら世界中に通用しませんよ。ただエキゾチズムのね興味だけであじゃあ何にも通用しない。僕はもう日本人としてただ日本人として考えたことを本当に日本人としてこう一生懸命作ってるだけであってね何もその受けようと思ってちっともそういうことは全然考えてませんよ。
When the Rashomon shoot was finished at the Komyoji temple location, I went to pay my respects to the abbot. He set a folding fan before me. In commemoration of our filming, he had written on the fan three characters forming a Chinese poem.Characters read, benefit all mankind. I was left speechless.
Which followed, Kurosawa was to make a succession of masterpieces, which focused on individuals trying to live virtuous lives amidst hardship and adversity.
I am a maker of films. Films are my true medium. I think that in order to learn what became of me after Rashomon, the most reasonable procedure would be to look for me in the characters in the films I made. Although human beings are incapable of talking about themselves with total honesty, it is much harder to avoid the truth while pretending to be other people. They often reveal much more about themselves in a very straightforward way. I'm certain that I did. There is nothing that says more about its creator than the work itself.
Akira means to live, and is about an ineffectual bureaucrat who discovers that he's dying of cancer and devotes the final months of his life to helping others. In the film, Watanabe dies in the community playground, which he built against all official opposition. Self-sacrifice and moral commitment are the central themes running through many of Kurosawa's films, and they resonate with his own samurai background.
その作品でもやっぱり誠実にね、その人生をこう自分の職務がそれぞれあるわけでしょ。で、自分の才能もそれで生かさなきゃなんない。だからこう誠実にその自分の才能を精一杯伸ばしてね、生きるっていうことが一番正しいんだし、まあそういう人こそヒーローって言えるんじゃないんですかね。
生きるが終わった後でね、黒沢さん、今度は時代劇やろうやっていうわけ。それで時代劇ね。で、黒沢さん、どういうことやろうって言ったら、お前、侍の一日ぐらい考えられないかっていうわけね。ある日、侍が朝起きて、酒焼き沿って、曲げを自分で上の奥さんに言ってもらうのか、わからん言ってもらって、それで朝飯を食べて、 お城へ行って、それで些細な味噌をするんだけどね、その水で帰ってきて夕方で自分の家の庭で切腹して死ぬっていう侍の一日やろうっていうことになったわけね。それで僕が黒沢さんに水球がいろいろ調べたけどできないって言ったら猛烈に怒っちゃってね、できないわけやないだろうってこうものすごく怒るんだけど。
Kurosawa insisted that the script must be based on actual events, so he and his team probed deeper into Japanese history for more information about samurai.
あの泥棒の多い時代だから、村へ入って夜寝ずに晩をするということにすれば必ず一晩止めて悪霊寂しを暮らしてくれる。どこの村へ入ってもそれは大丈夫だっていうこと。それでこれでいけると
百姓が侍宿って向こうの山に山賊がいると、そういう話が成立するんじゃないかっていうことになったわけ。Even a good director can't possibly make a good film. For truly cinematic expression, the camera and the microphone must be able to cross both fire and water. The script must be something that has the power to do this.
これが七人の侍の台本です。これは、これが七人の侍。 みんな持ってますこの本は。でも、まあ、私だけですから、このこういうの書くのはしょうがない。自分の編集のために書いてくる。それでこれがみんな雨とか風で、あの時こもってるもんだから、こんなに、ボロボロになってしまいまして、私の一番ボロボロの台本がこれです。これが確か8000のところだな。こんな感じ、こんなに長いシーンがないんですから。このシーンは、シークエンスが最後がね、200いくつかですよ、一番最後が274。普通羅生門は57ですから、シーンが。これから考えてもいかに長いかと思うでしょ。
シーンの侍とあの村とのね、村の人たちとの関係を描いて、あの七人の侍のそれぞれのキャラクターをね、人間をちゃんと描こうと思ったら描いたんですよ。侍っていうのはもう特殊な存在だしね、そのある戒律があるし、ある考え方があるし、その正義感もあるし、で教育のされ方も違ってるわけでしょ。そういう人間が役所の中に入って、そのいわば野党の群れとね、
これはもうチーフの助監督が立てるわけですよ。で僕はだいたい3ヶ月ぐらいでできるんじゃないかと、撮影期間がですよ、完成じゃありませんよと思ってたら、これが延々1年、撮影だけで1年かかってしまったんですね。だからこれはもう僕の考えたのと大幅に違ってきちゃったんで、まあ大変困った、会社も困ったし、僕も困ったし。あれだけ降らないと気に入らないわけですよね。で僕なんか、いわゆる山水の車を3台用意すればいいかなと思ったら、ダメだってこんなんじゃ、だからそれ倍にしろとかね、だからもう徹底的な、つまりだからあれで効果があったわけですよね。あれだけ降らしたら、もう僕らこういう長い、あの何、長靴履いてそこの中歩くわけですよ。だからもうドロドロですからね、こう長靴履いててもこう上げるのにすごい力がいるわけ。
余裕ないか、みんな一緒、とにかく、もうあと何日、あとこれだけなんてね、頑張ってやったんですけどね。やっぱりあれが雨じゃなかったら、ああいう何、あの合戦の必死さっていうのがね、天気のいい時なかなか演技じゃできないもん。
大体入り口になった
の。昔はこんなとこは裏門の小さいとこだったし、桜もねこんなになかったんだもん、小さ大きくなかったから。
Seven Samurai was the most expensive film ever to be made at Toho Studios, largely because it went 4 times over schedule. Kurosawa and his crew managed to complete the film, but the production brought Toho to the brink of bankruptcy.
It battled the main office to get the money and the time, and battled the actors to get the performances, and battled the weather to get what he wanted. And so this way of getting what he wanted in a nation where usually you get what you wanted through much slyer and more roundabout ways, this, the directness of giving orders and things gave him this reputation as being a disciplinarian. And so this started his problems with the press. And they're the ones who first started calling him Tenno, emperor.
Kurosawa's gamble paid off. Seven Samurai was a huge hit in Japan, and its reception in the West confirmed his reputation as an artist of global proportions.
In order to write scripts, you must first study the great novels and dramas of the world. You must consider why they are great. Where does the emotion come from that you feel as you read them? What degree of passion did the author have to have in order to portray the characters and events as he did? You must read thoroughly to the point where you can grasp all these things.
マクベスを読んでね、その大変面白かったし、いろいろ考えさせられたし。で、日本の戦国時代っていうのはね、シェイクスピアが描いてるあの時代ととても似て、同じような人物がたくさんいるんですよ。それで彼はこうシェイクスピアを日本の話にしても何のこう無理もなくね、こう移植できたわけですよね。
In Kurosawa's version of Macbeth, the characters are instantly recognizable. Asagi, the character based on Lady Macbeth, was played by the great Japanese stage
こういう感じが Asagi のあのね、黒沢さんがしてほしいメイクだったんだと思うんですが、この目ができないんですよね。まばたきは絶対しないでくれって言われたんです。あなたは能面なんですけど、あのこの表そのものが山田五十の浅地の顔であってほしいということですね。ですからあの喜怒哀楽もあんまりあの普通の映画みたいに表せるんじゃなくて、顔は無表情で体で表現するという。ですから今も見ててそう思うんですけど、あの顔は動いてないですよね。一番難しいのはあの手を洗う、血を洗うところを家に帰って何べんも何べんもあの水道の水で洗ってあのやってました。あの手を洗ってあの狂ってからのとこで、テストなしでやりましょうって言われて、と思ったんですよ。テストなしでやると思って、それでも胸ドキドキさせてやったんですけど、いっぺんどけって言われた時はね、もう本当に嬉しかったです。
能の表現っていうのはまあちょっと世界中に類例のない表現の仕方するわけでね、それがまた大変強烈なんですよね。でそれを借りないとね、あの場合そのあの強烈なあれが出ないしね。でまあ自然に僕は能が好きだし、いつも見てたから、それが自然にあそこに出てきたわけですけどね。
Some people have said that one of the contributions that Mifune made willy-nilly was that by working with Kurosawa for such a very long time, Kurosawa was able to inhabit him to an extent that he could reveal, although he might not have known he was doing it, aspects of himself. Not that they looked alike or acted alike or thought alike. It is an example of symbiosis. A very rare, I think, example of this, where one is not to be thought of except in terms of the other. Mifune was Mr. Nice Guy from beginning to end. He was the least difficult man in the world. He was the most unsure of himself. All of these things then were complemented by the things that Kurosawa was. And perhaps it was just this pliability, I don't know, that appealed to him.
The speed of his movements was such that he said in a single action what took ordinary actors three separate movements to express. And yet with all his quickness, he also had surprisingly fine sensibilities. I'm a person who is rarely impressed by actors, but in the case of Mifune, I was completely overwhelmed.
I've seen a Japanese film before when I saw this. And that character in there especially struck me because of his directness, of his total concentration, of that very interesting look that he always had in. I mean, that's a character that's was totally unique. I hadn't seen that in American film. You never see that. And I think, God, why can't they make films like that here?
In 1960, Kurosawa's Seven Samurai was remade by John Sturges as the Magnificent Seven. James Coburn was cast in the part of the knife-throwing cowboy, which was based directly on Kurosawa's Samurai Swordsman.
I just wanted to try to do it. Set that character down in a in Western terminology, but use that same kind of grace, that same kind of consciousness. Because the Western was basically a melodrama. That's where it came from, and it probably lasted until probably The Magnificent Seven, because it grew up at that time and became something else.
ですから、例えば、用心棒にしても、七人の侍にしても、その、彼が作ると、外国の方からそれを原作をシナリオをね、本案して映画化したいっていうのは注文が来てるわけでしょ。だからそういうなんか共通点はどっかにあるんじゃないでしょうか。それでいて映画自体はもう日本映画ですけれどもね。
Memories did that bring back?
Well, I haven't seen this movie in some years, but it was a fabulous movie when I saw it. It was the second Kurosawa film that I had ever seen, the first one being Seven Samurai, which I was quite taken with as a young man. And then a friend of mine suggested we go down to a little theater on Western Avenue in Los Angeles and see this film by this man who had done The Seven Samurai called Yojimbo. So we went down there and watched it, and at the time, about halfway through the picture, I said, this would make a wonderful Western, but nobody would ever have nerve to do it.
I don't think it's nice you laughing.
my mule don't like people laughing. He gets the crazy idea you're laughing at him.
What I loved about the Kurosawa piece was that it was the hero, or the protagonist, was so completely self-absorbed. He didn't care about anything. It's just the manipulation. He had no altruistic kind of feelings about anything or anybody at that particular time in his career. He's a wandering samurai. Or in my case, it was a wandering gunman, and it's fun to enter into a character that has absolutely no feelings about anything. In fact, he resists any compassion he might have along the way. He purposely sets that aside.
Okay, look, two eyes. Yeah, probably three.
Work orphans.
Is something that might be called cinematic beauty. It can only be expressed in a film, and it must be present for that film to be a moving work. When it is very well expressed, one experiences a particularly deep emotion while watching that film.
All right.
I believe that it is this quality that draws people to come and see a film, and that it is the hope of attaining this quality that inspires the filmmaker to make his film in the first place.
Filming on Redbeard took nearly 2 years to complete, and relations between Toshiro Mifune and Kurosawa strained to breaking point. One of the finest collaborations in Japanese cinema came to a bitter end.
Redbeard is the movie that brings to a close so many things in this period of filmmaking that had occupied Kurosawa since the war. Since the late 40s. It marks a real end of something, a turning point, a transition for him.
I said that I felt that with Redbeard that maybe one period is over and a new period was going to begin. He said, well, I really don't know what I want to do now. And then he said that they'd been fishing around the 20th Century Fox, and they either maybe make a co-production. That seemed to be a next possible thing. Well, it turned out, given his character and given the circumstances, it was not a good choice.
In 1968, Fox executives Daryl F. Zanuck and Elmer Williams flew to Japan to announce that Kurosawa was to direct the Japanese sequences in a lavish wartime epic about the attack on Pearl Harbor.
They allowed him all sorts of things, but they did make one fatal error. They said that, yeah, the other director, the other half, could be done by somebody of the caliber of David Lean. That was a name that Kurosawa knew about and had seen a couple of films. And instead, they gave him Richard Fleischer. Now, Richard Fleischer is a perfectly good director, but indeed, he is not commonly thought to be of the caliber of David Lean. And so the first indication that these people were not to be trusted was when Kurosawa learned this.
Attack on Pearl Harbor, as told from both the United States and Japanese sides. Para, para, para!
アメリカの映画の撮り方と今までの撮り方の違い、それが大きな問題だったんですね。要するに契約の中であまりに細かい契約がなされてて、1日撮影に対しての報告することが多すぎる、それと極端なこと言うと、その1日お酒飲んでいい量が決まってるとかね、そんなことを無視してやればよかったんだと思うんですけどね。
After 3 weeks shooting, Kurosawa left the production, and none of the footage he directed was used in the final film.
そんなには怒っている瞬間は見てないんですけれども、その家の中の空気がね、すごくおかしかったっていうのは覚えてますし、その報道陣に追っかけられて、そのホテルからホテルにずっと逃げ回っているっていう記憶はあるんですよ、母と一緒に。そのよく映画であるじゃないですか、トランクをバッと開けてその洋服を放り込んでっていうのは覚えてるんですけど。
By 1968, television was taking over Japan, and the few studios still operating were turning out cheap monster movies.
ヒューマニズムがちゃんと出てると思ったんですが、僕たちはね、少し暗いって言ったんですよ。やはり四季の会っていうものを作ったこの趣旨から言うとね、第一作はもうちょっとこう明るくダーンというんで打ち出そうと思ってたものですからね。
Dodeska Den was a box office failure, and the Four Knights never made a film again. For Kurosawa, this was an unbearable humiliation. On December 22nd, 1971, Kurosawa locked himself in the bathroom and slashed himself with a razor more than 30 times.
僕はその日うちにいましたし、お手伝いさんがびっくりして飛んできて、それで僕が一番最初に行って、それですぐ話処理したんですけどね。まあ基本的に精神的な疲れでしょうね。うちの親父にそれはもう僕が怒ったんだけどね、病室でね、いい加減にしろよ、人の迷惑になることやめろよっつって怒ったんだけど、ただ聞いてたけど。
下に降りていって、そしたらもう毛布にくるまれてね、うちの母がそばについてると、パパ大丈夫大丈夫ってやってて、その病院について、まあ、すぐにね、まあ、これは大丈夫だと、命には別状がありませんっていうことで、その日の昼頃でしょうかね、お見舞いに行った時は、まあ、元気にしてましたよね。でちょっと照れくさそうな顔をしてましたね。うん。
Над ледяным простором озера стояла глубокая тишина. В этом молчании таилась какая-то угроза человеку.
In 1972, Kurosawa accepted an offer to make a film in Russian in the Soviet Union, where a state studio system was still in operation. He worked with a largely Russian crew. The film took more than 3 years to complete. Shot mainly on location in Siberia, Dersu Uzala tells the story of an expedition to survey the wilderness at the turn of the century.
He's in the wilderness himself. He's now a filmmaker who is not respected by younger directors in his own country. He's a filmmaker who can't get funding to work from his own industry. He's got to kind of go with his hat in his hand overseas to continue to work. I mean, imagine how dispiriting that must have been for one who lived to make movies like Kurosawa did, who was alive when he made movies, and then not to be able to make them. How dispiriting. And, you know, is it any wonder that the later movies would be as pessimistic as they are?
やっぱりでも黒沢さんの作品はみんなどれでも大変だけど、肉体的にも大変で、本当にハードだったのは7人とデルスですね。デルスの時は非常に条件悪かったですからね。その前にその自殺未遂があった後でしょ。でもうとにかくが作品で成功しなかったら、もう一回出るのが難しいような、もうつまりなんていうのかね、追い詰められた状況ですから、彼も本当に、なんていうのかな、なんかかけてるようなね、つまりその作品にそれで一生懸命だったんだと思うんですけど、大変でしたよやっぱり。
дальше наш поход складывался тяжело。
Пошли, пошли.
Суровые морозы, усталость, голод. Слишком мал человек перед лицом великой природы.
In 1976, Dersu Uzala won the Academy Award for Best Foreign Language Film. Increasingly long gaps between films, Kurosawa needed to find additional sources of income. One, was a series of Japanese whiskey commercials, which were shot mainly at his house in the country, in which he directed and appeared in himself.
Suntory Reserve.
Kurosawa-san's別荘です. ここへ入るのも本当に久しぶりです。
ここは御殿場で撮影するときにはここへ泊まります。あとは東京から離れてゆっくりしたいとかプライベートな時間を過ごすときにこの別荘を使います。それで僕たちもご一緒に来てここで過ごすことになります。人が集まらないんで、でこうそれから、ああいう材料はお客が入らないっていうね、工業サイドの変な
Kurosawa was able to make Kagemusha only with assistance from outside Japan. Francis Coppola raised the budget with the help of his friend George Lucas, whose recent hit Star Wars was inspired by the work of Kurosawa.
From the moment production begins to the moment it ends, there is no telling what will happen. The director must be able to respond to any situation, and he must have the leadership ability to make the whole unit go along with his responses. I often say, although I'm certainly not a militarist, that if you compare the production unit to an army, the script is the battle flag and the director is the commander of the front line.
In Kagemusha, Kurosawa returned to the age of the samurai to make an epic about loyalty and the battles between rival clans. But by now, his vision had darkened, and the film is a powerful depiction of the horrors of war. It ends in an apocalyptic and bloody massacre, which recalls Kurosawa's most traumatic childhood memory.
When I involuntarily looked away, my brother scolded me. Akira, look carefully now. My brother said, if you shut your eyes to a frightening sight, you end up being frightened. If you look at everything straight on, there's nothing to be afraid of.
っていうのはさ、だってもう本当の大昔から同じ言葉ばっかりしてるわけよ。え？なぜそれを繰り返すっていうのかね。人間っていうのはこういう絶望的な状態になってるんだぞと。これを突き抜けるためにはどうしたらいいのかっていうことを考えようじゃないかっていうことを僕は言ってるんであって、それはペシミズムでも何でもないよって言ったんですよ。 むしろそれを回避してね、そういうものを直視しようとしないのこそ消極的な態度って、ペシミズムだと言えるんじゃないかね。え？
When he needed to recover from shooting a film or find the time to write, Kurosawa would often go to Kyoto and stay for several weeks at the same modest inn. After Kagamusha, Kurosawa returned to work on a script based on Shakespeare's King Lear called Ron.
これが黒沢明さんがお書きになった影武者の時の絵コンテなんです。影武者でもってランで、どうしても必要とするようなものをいろいろたくさん鎧だとかなんかを作ったわけですよね。で、それだけランの費用が安くなるわけでしょ。こちらが先生があのお仕事をされてたお部屋でございます。ここにテーブル 机を置きまして、あのシナリオを書かれた時は8月のラプソディーと、それから雨上がるのシナリオをここでずっとお書きになってました。朝起きられて朝ごはん召し上がってすぐもここへ戻ってきて、ここからここでずっと夜6時ぐらいまで一生懸命書いておられましたね。
Ron had become Kurosawa's obsession, and he constantly imagined the images he would one day film. For 5 long years, he made drawings of its warring armies and its central character, Lord Hidetora, who, like King Lear, gives away his kingdom and finally descends into madness.
Was Kurosawa himself more and more detached from reality? Well, first you'd have to ask how attached to reality Kurosawa was in the first place. Like any great creator, he's attached to what he's making. He's attached to his own version of himself. The reality which he created is the reality which he needed. For example, the man had absolutely no small talk at all. You couldn't talk about... He wasn't interested in talking about the weather. He wasn't interested in anything like that. When he wanted to talk to you, he wanted to talk to you because he wanted to pick your brains about the new project. And that's all he ever talked about with anybody. It was about the project at hand, just like his favorite film was always the next one.
In 1984, Kurosawa reassembled his film unit and began shooting Ron on the barren slopes of Mount Fuji.
これがね、ランの時の電波の近くです。それで三の城って、あの城を燃やした作ったところがあそこの場所になりますね。で、三の城の門がちょうどそこから追いつきた、その下あたりのところが入り口になります。
さんの映画はいつも危険が伴うので、もうそれは入る時に覚悟してますけれども、特にこのシーンは僕はじめですね、あの城の中にこう出てくるわけですね。でどんどん城が燃えて、その途中から秀虎が出てくるわけですけど、中に誰かいると思ったんですよ。助監督さんとか制作の人とか、いざという時に。そしたらですね、これ全部燃えるまで、燃やしちゃうまで撮るわけですから、僕一人しかいられないわけです、城の中に。約8台のカメラで狙ってるもんですから、それ何億かかかった城ですよ。これ僕がちょっと一転びすれば NG になるんで。
影武者後ろ、乱にしろ、ああいう結婚の写真はあれでね、やるだけのことをやったんだから、ね、もっと違ったものを今度は考えてるんですけど、
films Kurosawa was drawn back to the world of his childhood.
よくうちの父が言ってたのは、やっぱり映画もね、いつまでも七人の侍を撮ってるわけいかないじゃないかと。自分も年取るから興味も変わるし、その体力も変わってくるし、その人間っていうのはやっぱりだんだん達観してくるものだしね。でそのもう時間がないと思えば、夢みたいにいろんなそのなんて試みをたくさんやってみたくなったり、その自由奔放に反対に年いった方がなれるし、その人の批評なんて気にせずに自分の好きなものが撮れるようになるし。
Kurosawa continued to make films into his mid-80s. He is seen here directing what was to be the very final shot of his last film.
やっぱりその本人はもちろん映画しかないから、その死ぬまでいつもあのテレビでビデオをかけて、そのいろんな人の映画を見たり、自分の昔の映画を見たりして、映画に対する愛情っていうのはすごくあったわけですよね。だけどでもだんだんだんだんこう、なんていうのかしら、こう火が消えていくように、だんだんこう生命力がなくなっていく、元気がなくなっていく感じっていうのがあって。 あるところまでは一生懸命パパもっと一生懸命映画撮ろう撮ろうっていう風に言ってられたんだけれども、なんか普通のおじいさんでこのまんま静かにさせててあげたいなと思い始める一瞬っていうのがあってね、これ以上そういうことを言ってはかわいそうかなと。
September 1998, at the age of 88, Kurosawa died. His memorial service was attended by more than 35,000 people.
Looking back over my life, what is there for me to say, except that a lot has happened? Many people have suggested that I write an autobiography, but I have never before felt favorably disposed towards the idea. This is partly because I believe that if I were to write anything at all, it would turn out to be nothing but talk about movies. In other words, take myself, subtract movies, and the result is zero.
お水よりウイスキーの方がいいかも。
はい、
ありがとうございました。じゃあこれ持っていきましょう。
This and other great performances programs, visit pbs.org or America Online keyword PBS. Kurosawa is available on VHS for $24.98 and DVD for $34.98 plus shipping. To order, call 1-800-336-1917 or write to the address on your screen.